IMNCI. I'm Dr. Khalid Shafi, Associate Professor, Department of Community Medicine, Law Medical College. So we start with lecture. Today's lectures, our learning objectives are, at the end of the session, those who are attending will learn goals of IMNCI, age groups and problems covered by IMNCI guidelines. Number three, color-coded case management strategy. And number four is the IMNCI case management steps. In fact, there will be two lectures of IMNCI. Today's lecture will concentrate on the reasons why the IMNCI was developed, then how it works, what is the strategy, and what is the case management steps. And we'll discuss some diseases which are being covered by that. The second lecture will cover the remaining part of the IMNCI. So IMNCI is, in fact, integrated management of neonatal and childhood illness. Actually, its name is very descriptive. What does it mean? Integrated means different approaches which were designed for the diseases like the diarrhea, pneumonia, etc., malnutrition are combined together. It covers the neonatal in the childhood age, and the major diseases are covered in this IMNCI strategy. So we can say that it's a strategy by which neonatal and childhood illnesses are treated according to certain guidelines which have been standardized. Dear students, this is very important to learn that main diseases which are very common, there should be a standard guideline, standard way of procedure of managing those diseases, diagnosing and managing that. Because if every doctor starts writing its own medicine or uses its own criteria for the diagnosis, then the things will not be standardized and the quality will not be maintained. So IMNCI, the reasons why the IMNCI was developed is that according to WHO report, children belonging to low and middle income countries like Pakistan, Bangladesh, India, African countries, they're 10 times more likely to die before reaching 5 years of age than those living in the industrialized world. These four lines are very sad, very tragic. It means if you are born in a country like Pakistan and if you are born in a country like Singapore or Australia, here, the chances of dying before 5 years of age is 10 times higher. Everyone who is born is bound to die. That is the nature. But the age of dying is not 1 month, 2 months, 5 years. The physical age, even in Pakistan, is 63 plus. And in the developed countries, it is 73, 74, 78 in some countries. What does it mean dying before 5 years of age? Great tragedy. Every year, millions of children die in the developing countries before reaching their fifth birthday. Even in Pakistan, more than 3 lakhs children die because of under 5 years of age, because of pneumonia, because of diarrhea, because of measles, because of congenital malformations, because of infections, others, malaria, malnutrition, main contributor to the death. The goals of IMNCI. We have discussed some of these in the definition, but let's go again through it. Number one is the standardized case management of the sick, newborn and children. I've already explained that there should be a standard. Focus on the most common causes of mortality. There are more than 3 lakh children dying in Pakistan. So, most common causes are there, and we know that we are going to discuss that. The focus is, at least, we start saving our children. We concentrate on those causes, those diseases, which are causing death of our children in bulk. Of course, no one should die with a treatable cause. But certain diseases are so common. And if our healthcare providers learn and develop the skill to manage those cases, to prevent and manage those conditions, we can save many, many, the three children die, we can save more than 2.5 lakh children. Third goal of the MNCI is, first was a standardized case management, second is focus on the most common causes of mortality, third is a nutrition assessment and counseling for all the sick infants and children. If a child is malnourished, the consequences of disease are extremely different. The chances of dying with a diarrhea and the pneumonia is manifold increased if the child is malnourished as compared to child who is of the normal average birth weight. So, I mean, say, beside stressing on the standardized case management, focus on the most common causes of mortality, also includes the nutrition assessment and counseling for all the sick infant and children. Every baby, every child who is coming to see a doctor, as per IMNCI protocol, the doctor should look the nutritional assessment. Doctor should weigh the baby, should check the anemia, should check the edema. We'll discuss this in the second lecture. And then we'll classify the child, how malnourished the child is. If the child is well nourished, doctor will praise the mother. It's another part, important part. And if the child is not well nourished, malnourished, then we'll counsel as required. And the fourth part is, what our doctors do, it addresses to that. If you observe, our doctors at Civil Hospital are everywhere. We do write medicine to the patient and say, take this medicine and go home. But we do not stress on the home care, especially for the newborn baby. So IMNCI, the fourth goal is to home care for the newborns, to promote the exclusive breastfeeding, prevent hypothermia, improve illness recognition and timely care seeking. Every baby who is coming to see a doctor, the doctor will tell them, if the child is under 2 years of age, a newborn, please breastfeed the baby. Do not give anything other than breastfeed till 6 months of age. Keep the baby properly wrapped according to the weather. If it's cold weather, you should avoid hypothermia. If it's a hot weather, you should avoid hyperthermia. And doctor has to tell the mother, what are the major signs, alarming signs? Like the child is not feeding, child becomes cynos, etc. We'll discuss what are the danger signs. Mother should recognize that child is sick and when she should immediately, urgently come to the healthcare provider. So the essential components of MNCR are improve health and nutrition workers' skill. Healthcare workers' skill is an important part. IMNCI training, it's actually a 5 days training from 8 a.m. to 5 p.m. Very strict sort of training with a practical element. It improves the healthcare and the nutrition workers' skill. They learn how to diagnose, how to classify, how to treat. Then this essential component also improves the health system. There should be a separate OPD for the children under 5 years. It is there in the Civil Hospital, Karachi. There is an MNCI clinic. Children under 5 years of age go to that clinic. And it improves family and community practices. When the doctor gives counseling to the mother about how she should feed, how she should give the nutrition, how she should recognize the early signs of disease, when there is emergency to go to doctor, when you can come to doctor on the next day. These are essential components of MNCI. The potentials of the adopted MNCI package is that it will help in accelerating the reduction in the infant and child mortality in both rural and urban areas, particularly by its impact on the neonatal mortality through home and facility-based care. Students, we have discussed in the previous lectures, infant care, maternal care, MNCH indicators, and vaccination, that our infant, neonatal infant and under 5 mortality is very high. In fact, highest in the region and almost on the top in the world also. Only few countries have worse indicator than us. This IMNCH package The potential is there if our healthcare workers are skilled and they start practicing, our infant and child mortality will be decreasing start. Not mortality, morbidity will also decreasing. If the health worker is properly skilled at a primary care hospital and dispensary, then every baby does not need to come to Civil Hospital Karachi or the Oja Hospital or the other big hospitals. So if the doctors are skilled, they start preventing the disease, promoting the healthy hygienic and healthy practices, and early recognize the diseases at the primary level, then it will lower the burden to hospital, particularly in the urban area where the access to care is not a limiting factor. In fact, you go to the OPD at this time, it's 9 a.m., there will be thousands of the people in the queues, making slips, taking medicine, waiting for the doctors to see. These people do not need to come to Civil Hospital Karachi. This is a tertiary care hospital, only very sick and the complicated patients should come here. So the doctors will have the sufficient time to concentrate. Instead of examining 200 patients per day, they should examine only 20, 30 patients with concentration. But this will happen if the minor illnesses are taken care at the primary level and treated there only. Serious conditions refer to the Civil Hospital Karachi or the NICH or the other places. So this is, I mean, PSI package will help to save the children, to save the time of the doctors. And doctors will not only manage the common diseases, but in the tertiary care hospitals, when there is no overcrowding, they will have the time to treat the serious patients, the complicated patients, rare disease also. The problems covered by MNCI are cough or difficult breathing, very common problem, then diarrhea, ear problems, fever and measles, malnutrition and anemia, and feeding problems. These are the main problems which are covered by the MNCI. For many children, a single diagnosis may not be apparent or appropriate. Integrated management of neonatal and child illness. This is integrated management because we know if the child may have many problems at the same time. For example, if the child is having cough or fast breathing, number one, he may have pneumonia, but at the same time, it can be due to anemia, or anemia may be, severe anemia may be there, or even in the falciparum malaria, child has cough, child has difficulty in breathing. Similarly, if the child is lethargic and unconscious, cerebral malaria, meningitis, severe dehydration, very severe pneumonia. So the sick children may have more than one condition, more than one diagnosis. Measles with rash, child may have measles, also at the same time pneumonia, child usually have diarrhea, ear infection. Then if a very sick young infant, we call in MNCI the children under 2 months of age, from birth to 2 months of age, they will label it here as a young infant. Do not forget, we will ask you in the exam, what is meant by young infant? Young infant is very sick. There will be more than one diagnosis, meningitis, pneumonia, sepsis, etc. So there should be holistic approach to a child, not missing anything. If a child comes to a doctor, the doctor should not miss at least major things. Disease, immunization status, feeding practices, malnutrition, etc., all these things. So the MNCI case management steps are assess signs of illness and general condition of child. Number first step is that the healthcare provider assess the signs of illness and general condition of child. Then he classify the child according to the signs and symptoms detected. We'll go into detail, it is just outlined. You should concentrate on this. These are very important. Assess the signs of illness and general condition. Number one is assessment. Number two is classify. Classify the child according to the signs and symptoms detected. Then identify the treatment. Number four is treat according to classification. Number five is consult the mother. Consult the mother on the treatment, on the preventive and general health promoting measures, and mother's own health. Number six, provide follow-up care for illness and feeding problems. Follow-up care means you tell the patient when to return, 2 days, 3 days accordingly. It's given in detail with every condition. When to come urgently and what are the signs and symptoms when the child should come, mother should bring the child early. So the IMNCI case management steps are assess, classify, identify the treatment, treat according to classification, counsel the mother, and provide follow-up care. Look at this. Assessment is the first part, but other parts are also important. Even our doctor ends practically on the treat according to condition. 5 and 6 part is missing. Counsel the mother and provide follow-up care. It is missing in general practice, in the practice of all the doctors almost in Pakistan. Our training and the practice is a bit faulty. It should not be like this. We should go through these 6 steps with every child, every disease. So the age groups covered by IMNCI guidelines are, number one, IMNCI addresses under 5 years of children as a 2 age categories for the case management. Number one, children from 2 months to 5 years, including children from 2 months to 59 months, same thing. First category. Second category is young infant from birth up to 2 months, including infant from 0 to 59 days. So children under 5 years are divided into 2 groups. The IMNCI training and the case management steps are divided into parts because the diseases and their management is slightly different. So we go ahead, move ahead. There is color-coded management strategy. When we assess a child, we classify the child. Classification, the child is placed in one of the 3 categories. Pink classification, child needs inpatient care. Yellow classification, child needs specific treatment, which can be provided at home. That's an OPD patient. You prescribe the drug and send, go home, come after 2-3 days. Green classification means child needs no medicine, advice, home care. Again, the same thing. IMNCI guidelines are action-oriented. If there is pink, a severe condition, pink means a severe condition which requires hospitalization, urgent life-saving, urgent referral to hospital. If you are sitting in the hospital, then admit the child, manage the child in the hospital. And if you are sitting at a clinic, primary health center, etc., refer to the hospital. That is a pink classification. Then the yellow, this is a moderate condition that requires treatment with antibiotics or the other medicine and follow. It is done at the OPD. It can be done at the primary healthcare level also. Then comes green, mild condition that requires only home care, just advises. Tell him what are the danger signs, how we can prevent further deterioration, etc. So, dear students, this was a brief introduction of the IMNCI. Now we move forward to the practical application of the IMNCI. First age group, we'll discuss these 2 categories. First categories, which we just will start discussing, is the age group from the 2 months to 5 years. Second lecture, we will also discuss the young infant that is under 2 months of age. So, 2 months to 5 years. The child's problems which are included in the IMNCI are the cough, diarrhea, ear problems, malnutrition, etc. So if the child has, for example, cough, we start with the cough because the pneumonia is the major killer of the children. We start the cough. Whatever the symptom child say, cough, diarrhea, etc. Every child, first of all, we check for the general danger sign in all children. What is the problem? We'll go into the problem after this. The child has a cough, okay, we'll go to cough. But before going to cough, every child will come to the hospital. What's your name? What is your age? Where is the child? And then ask what's the problem. By the time you're asking what's the problem, you will also assess general danger signs. You will ask only 3 questions. Is the child able to drink or breastfeed? Does the child vomit everything? Has the child had convulsion during the current illness? You'll ask 3 things. Is the child able to drink? If the child is vomiting everything, has the child had convulsions during the current illness? And you will look only 2 things. See if the child is lethargic or unconscious. See if the child is convulsing now. It means if a mother brings a 3-year-old child to me, she sits beside me. I greet the mother. Assalamualaikum. Kya haal hai? Bacche ki tabiyat kaisi hai? Then I ask, kya bacha doodh pi raha hai, kuch kha pi raha hai? She will say, nahi kuch bhi nahi kha raha, ulti kar raha hai. Kya har cheez ulti kar raha hai? जी जी कुछ भी नहीं पेट में ठहर रहा, सब उल्टी कर रहा है. बच्चे को खींच तो नहीं आई थी, झटके तो नहीं पड़े थे? हाँ हाँ, रात को इसकी आंखें ऊपर को हो गई थी, हाथ अकड़ गए थे. दीज आर द जनरल डेंजर साइंस यू विल आस्किंग. एंड एट द सेम टाइम व्हाइल वी आस्किंग द मदर, वी लुक द चाइल्ड इज लेथार्जिक अनकॉन्शियस. द चाइल्ड इज प्लेइंग इन द मदर्स लैप, pushing your stethoscope, etc., trying to get down, trying to walk. Child is conscious. Other child who is lying apathetically in the mother's, just opening the eyes and closing, are slowly responding. The lethargic child. A child may not be doing anything like this, unconscious child. Number second thing, you will look if the child is having convulsions, seizures, fits at that same time when you're examining or you're taking the history. So there are 5 things only in the general range of science, no big science. Child able to drink or breastfed? Does the child vomit everything? Has the child had convulsions? And you will look if the child is lethargic and unconscious and see if the child is convulsing now. If any of this is present, then it means the child is very sick. We have done this in detail. Number one, is the child unable to drink or suck? If the child is not able to drink or suck, when offered a drink, it means he is not taking feed. This is a part of serious illness. If the child is vomiting everything, again, this is a serious problem. Similarly, if the child had convulsions during the current illness, not the previous, the child had seizure 2 years back, that's not important. Important is that in the last 3, 4, 5 days during the current illness, and the child is having convulsion in front of you. Similarly, lethargic and unconscious child. These things, if are present, we classify it very severe disease. Students have discussed, we'll assess the child, we'll classify, we will identify the treatment, we'll treat the child. So, if any of these 5, anyone is present, it means the child is having very severe disease. We label it as very severe disease. And what is the actions we do? Treat convulsions if present, the child is having fits. You will control the fits. You will maintain an IVL and you will give injection Valium, etc. You will do the complete assessment immediately. If you are sitting in a primary care setup, you will give first dose of antibiotic immediately, intramuscular or IV. We will treat the child to prevent low blood sugar. If the child is conscious, can take orally, you will give glucose water. If the child is sick, you will maintain an IV line and start infusion. And after doing this, you will refer the child to the hospital. And if you are sitting at the civil hospital in the emergency room at the OPD, you will manage the child in the emergency room. And in the OPD, you will send to emergency room and you will admit the child, means manage the child in the hospital. So these are the classification as per general danger sign. After this, when we have, let's emphasize that general danger sign means this is a serious condition. Whenever present, a general danger sign should be considered in making a decision on the management of any other condition. So, first thing, every child who comes to OPD, civil hospital OPD, child comes, enrolls, weight is done, sent to the doctor. Doctor asks, kya hua aapko bacche ko? At the same time, before going to detail ke kya hua, he will ask and look for these 5 things. If the child do not have any of this, you will manage the general danger signs. And you, if child does not have the general danger sign, then you move to the first part, that is the cough. Assess the cough or the difficult breathing. We'll ask, bache ko khansi hai, mother kahegi ji hai. You will come into this chart of coughing, that is the ARI chart. If the mother say, nahi khansi to nahi hai, bilkul bhi khansi nahi hai. फिर क्या मोशन हो रहे हैं, दस्त हो रहे हैं? जी जी दस्त हो रहे हैं. अब आप डायरिया में चले जाएंगे, डायरिया के चार्ट में. इफ मदर सेज इसके कान में दर्द है, मदर सेज के कान में दर्द है, तो यू विल मूव टू द एयर प्रॉब्लम चार्ट. एंड इफ यू से दैट चाइल्ड इज हैविंग सम अदर प्रॉब्लम, मदर से हैज द फीवर, यू मूव टू द फीवर पार्ट. So let's go. You will understand in some time. If you ask the mother that child is having difficulty in breathing, mother say ke bache ko khansi ho rahi hai aur bache ko saath mein khansi liya ja raha hai. Then you will go like this. Ask about the main symptoms. Does the child have cough or difficult breathing? If yes, if the child has cough, you will just ask one question and you look and listen four things. Question is that how long? आपके बच्चे को कब से खांसी है? कितने दिनों से खांसी है? She will say 3 days, 4 days. We'll go into detail that. And then you look and listen for count the breath in 1 minute. Means you will count the respiratory rate of the child in 1 minute. You will look for the chest in drawing, and you will look and listen for the stridor. You will look and listen for the wheeze. So if a mother complains that the child has cough, you will ask how long the cough is there. You will count the breathing. You look for the chest in drawing. You look for the stridor and wheeze. Means how long the cough is there? What is the respiratory rate? Chest in drawing is there. Stridor is there or not? Wheeze is there or not? You will, after doing the assessment, you will be knowing that. So if we go to the, you will go to the detail of this. Cough for more than 3 weeks. For example, if the mother says that the child has cough and it is more than 3 weeks, then what you will do? More than 3 weeks cough is a chronic condition and needs further assessment. Okay, ji. Means further assessment means that child needs to be looked for asthma, foreign body, tuberculosis, whooping cough, etc. That cannot be done in an OPD setup or the setup like where adequate facilities are not there in the primary healthcare center. So if a child has cough for more than 3 weeks, even you are sitting in the civil hospital OPD, you will refer the child to the consultant who will do, will check thoroughly the child and then do chest x-ray or do some sputum test, or for the whooping cough, etc., will do something else. So you will refer the child. You will not manage the child according to as MNCI protocol. You will refer. This child needs expert opinion. Then if the child lower chest in drawing, inward move. What is lower chest in drawing? Lower chest, bony structure of the lower chest wall with the inspiration. With the inspiration means that when the child takes the breath, the lower chest wall moves. Occurs when the efforts of the child needs to breathe is much greater than the normal. What happens in the pneumonia? Some part of the lung is damaged. The oxygenation is not proper. The body tries to take more oxygen by doing more work. It's sort of that the chest starts running. It starts putting all in effort to take more weights, do more work, so as to get oxygen. This is an effort of the body. Lower chest in drawing is not subcostal detection. It is not intercostal chest in drawing detection. So one thing is that when you're looking for the lower chest in drawing, the child should be calm. It should be present all the time in all the positions. And most important thing with the assessment of the cough is that breathing of the child. If the child is, you will count the respiratory rate in 1 minute. If the age of the child is between 2 months to 12 months, 50 breaths per minute, above 50 breaths per minute means fast breathing. If the child is from 1 year to 5 years age, above 40 breaths per minute means fast breathing. I again repeat it. If the child is less than 2 months of age, 60 breaths per minute is a cutoff time. Means less than 60 normal, above than 60 means fast breathing. From 2 months to 1 year, 50 breaths is a cutoff point. Above 50 breaths means fast breathing. From 1 year to 5 years, 40 breaths per minute is a cutoff point. 60, 50, 40. If the child, for example, is 3 years old, what is the respiratory rate? Respiratory rate is 44. 44 means rapid breathing for a child of 3 years old. So 60, 50, 40. Count the respiratory rate in a calm and quiet child. Count for full 1 minute. Fever affects the respiratory rate. Respiratory rate is slightly increased, but it does never reach the cutoff points if other disease is not there. VZ pneumonia is not there. The other thing we will look in the child will, number one, will ask how long the cough is. Number two, will count the respiratory rate. Number three, will check, do look for the lower chest syndrome. Number three, will look for the stridor. Number four is the wheeze. What is the stridor? Stridor is a hard sound heard during the inspiration while the child is calm. It happens when there is a swelling of the larynx, trachea, and the epiglottis. Means upper airway, if there is swelling, the child has difficulty in taking in breath, that is inspiration. It's like exactly the sound this lick will be producing the child. This is stridor. It happens when there is swelling of the larynx, trachea, or the epiglottis. It can be life-threatening when the swelling causes a child's airway to be blocked. If child is having sound, it means in some time swelling may be increased and there may be total blockage. So this is a serious condition. Other thing you look and listen is a wheeze. What is wheeze? This is a soft musical sound heard during the expiration, breathing out in a calm child. So wheeze is an expiratory sound, inspiratory is an inspiratory sound. So you can listen the wheeze by holding your ear near the child's mouth. It may be caused by the swelling and narrowing of the small airways of the lungs by the contraction of the smooth muscles surrounding those airways. In a wheezy child, the breathing out requires great effort and the breathing out phase is longer than the normal. Mainly, the wheeze is produced from the lower chest, lungs, and the stridor is produced from the upper airways. So, after going these three possible classifications for a child with a cough and difficult breathing, we come. If the child has at least one sign in the pink, classify very severe disease. If the child has at least one sign in the yellow, we'll go to the what are the signs, classify as the pneumonia. And third is that if there is no sign, no positive thing, then we say no pneumonia. So we come to the detail of this in this chart. If the child have any danger sign or a stridor in a calm child, if there is a stridor present, you will call it very severe disease. If a child come to you, the child do not have the danger signs otherwise, but have cough, and you examine the child, you assess the child has the stridor. It is a danger sign. The child has very severe disease. You will classify the very severe disease. You will give first dose of the antibiotic, will treat the wheezing if present, treat the child to prevent low blood sugar, and refer urgently to the hospital. Or admit in the hospital, manage in the ER and the ward accordingly, the ICU, what is required. Stridor means very severe disease. Then, yellow classification. If the child has fast breathing or low chest syndrome, if both are present or only one is present, it means pneumonia. Pneumonia, you give an appropriate oral antibiotics for 5 days. If the wheezing is present, then nebulize the child or give oral bronchodilator. Give some safe remedy for the cough. And if the cough is more than 3 weeks, a recurrent wheeze, then refer to assessment for the TB and asthma. And every child whose you are treating as pneumonia, giving antibiotic 5 days, you will ask the mother to return immediately if the child develops stridor, start feeding, start vomiting everything, becomes unconscious, becomes cyanosis, etc. Otherwise, she should come for follow-up in 3 days. If the child you examine have cough, but no fast breathing, no chest syndrome, no stridor, no wheezing, it means the child has no pneumonia, just cough and cold. For cough and cold, if wheezing is there, you will give bronchodilator. For the cough, you will give safe home remedies like the honey, lukewarm water, etc. And you will advise the mother when to come urgently, and otherwise she should come after 3 days if the cough persists. So dear students, if a child comes to you in your clinic under between age of 2 to 5 years of age and you start examining the child, number one, you will look for the general danger sign. If there is no general danger sign, you will ask the main symptom. You will say, I have cough, my child has cough. You will assess the cough. Ask how long the cough is there. You look for the 4 things. You look for the if they're fast breathing or not, if there is lower chest syndrome or not, stridor or not, wheezing or not. On the basis of this, you will classify very severe disease. If the stridor is there, if fast breathing is there, or the lower chest syndrome, it will be pneumonia. And if there is no danger sign, there is no stutter, no wheeze, no fast breathing, no chest and dying, it means no. So, coming to the chart, if the child has at least one sign in the pink row, very severe disease. If signs of pneumonia, then called pneumonia, fast breathing and low chest and dying. If nothing we find, what we are looking, then no pneumonia and home remedy. So, we have managed the child with the cuff. Now, if the child do not have the cuff, for example, then what we will do? We ask, kya hai aapke bache ko? She will say, isko motion ho rahe hain, dust ho rahe hain. It means the child has diarrhea. Does the child have diarrhea? Now you look for that. In the diarrhea, the stool contain more water than normal and are more frequent. Stools are watery and the number is increased. The child is passing 2 stools, 3 stools, child pass 6, 7, 8 stools. Frequent passing of normal stool is not diarrhea. For example, if the stools are soft, the stools are not loose, passing instead of passing 3, child is passing 4, 5. It's not diarrhea. Similarly, exclusive breastfed infants often have soft stool. This is not diarrhea. The young children who are on the total breastfeed, they need to pass the stool 4, 5, 6 times a day. They are semi-soft, but it's not diarrhea. We call it breast milk diarrhea. It is a normal physiological phenomena. So do not start treating this normal phenomena. Mothers usually know when their children have the diarrhea. They know it. Because she's used how many stool child used to pass. So now we assess the diarrhea of child with the diarrhea. How we assess? We ask just 2 questions. For how long the diarrhea is there? Are the loose stools are there? Is there blood in the stool? 2 things only to ask. And at the same time, we'll look at the child's general condition. What we'll see in the general condition? Lethargic or unconscious, restless or irritable. We'll see the child is active, irritable, lethargic or conscious. There may be 3 things. Child may be normal behaving, child may be unconscious and lethargic, or child may be irritable, crying all the time, very eagerly. You will offer the child the fluid. And see, is the child not able to drink, or drinking poorly, drinking very eagerly, child is thirsty, offer the child the fluid, there will be 2 things. The child will not able to drink, or drinking poorly, well, lethargic, unconscious child will not drink. Child may drink normally. Is a child who has taken something, who is not thirsty, but he is not unconscious, may take a sip and leave it. And a thirsty child will be very eagerly, not letting you to remove the glass or cup from you. Then we'll pinch the skin of the abdomen and see, does it go back very slowly? Slowly means longer than 2 seconds. Or slowly, between 2 seconds to 0, and very rapidly. So students, if a child, mother complains, the child has loose stool, we'll see how long the loose stools are there, and if there, we'll ask how long the long stools are there, is there blood in the stool, then we'll look for these things according to general condition. As per general condition, lethargic, unconscious, restless, irritable, look for the sunken eyes. I forgot to mention, very important sign, look for the sunken eyes. Then offer the child fluid and then pinch the skin. Okay, we'll go one by one. How long the loose stools are there? Diarrhea, which lays for more than 14 days or more, is called the persistent diarrhea. The management of persistent diarrhea is little bit different. Number second, the question was, is there blood in the stool? A child who has diarrhea with the blood in the stool during the current episode of illness without mucus or pus, it means the child has dysentery. We'll take this data while we are in consideration while we classify the diarrhea. Okay, G. Look at the child's general condition. Look to see if the child is restless or irritable all the time, or every time he stretch or handle. If an infant or child is calm when the breastfeeding, but again restless and irritable when she stops breastfeeding, he has the signs of restless and irritable. We'll see that the child is restless and irritable and cannot be consoled easily. Mother try to change the position, take in the lip, take at the shoulder, starts giving something in the hand, in the mouth, but the child keeps irritating her. Then we look for the sunken eyes. Very important signs of diarrhea and dehydration. If the eyes are sunken, it means the child has dehydration. If you're in doubt, some children who are malnourished, their eyes are like they're sunken. The mother knows better. You'll ask the mother. Then offer the child, look to see if they offer the child some fluid. Look to see what the child does with it. If child is not able to drink, means child is not able to suck or swallow. The child may be lethargic and conscious. If the child is drinking poorly, child is weak, cannot drink without help, he may be able to swallow only if the fluid is put to his mouth. We look what his child is doing. Then, is the child drinking early or thirsty? Some children are very thirsty because of the diarrhea and they have drinking very eagerly, thirsty. If it is clear that the child wants to drink, the child reaches out for the cup or spoon when you offer, and when the water of the cup is taken away, the child is unhappy, starts crying, moving hands vigorously because he wants to drink. So you can assess the child when you offer the fluid, whether the child drinks it normally, not easily, lethargic or thirsty. Skin pinch, very important signs to assess the dehydration. You pinch the skin. Number one, you locate the area on the child abdomen, halfway between the umbilicus and the side of the abdomen. Look at the picture. After this, you place the thumb and the index finger on the abdomen. You firmly pick a longitudinal fold of all layers of skin and tissue under them. It should be not superficial. It should be firmly pick a longitudinal fold of all layers of skin and tissue under them. And then release the fold after 1 second. There is a wrong way if you just use your fingertips, because this will cause the pain to the child. So firmly pick up a longitudinal fold of all layers of the skin and the tissue under them and release the fold after 1 second. What happens now? If the skin pinch goes very slowly, longer than 2 seconds, this is an important assessment for the dehydration. Release the fold after 1 second. Look to see if the skin pinch goes back very slowly, longer than 2 seconds, or slowly the skin stays up for a brief time and you release in less than 2 seconds. It stays there, but it goes away in less than 2 seconds. And immediately you release the skin, pinch returns immediately back. There may be three possibilities: very slowly, slowly, and immediately. Now, on the basis of this assessment, we classify the dehydration. Number one, if two of the following signs are present, like lethargic or unconscious, sunken eyes, not able to drink, or drinking poorly, skin pinch goes back very slowly. Any two of the following, not all four, maybe all four, but two are necessary. If the sunken eyes are there and the child is lethargic, if the child is lethargic, skin pinch goes back very slowly. It is severe dehydration. Severe dehydration means plan C. We'll go in detail in the next lecture or the subsequent training. What is plan C? Plan C is actually needs, it's a severe dehydration. It needs urgent therapy. If the therapy is present in the health center, like the IV fluids, start there. If the therapy is not available, then doing some initial treatment, refer urgently to hospital. And during the way, giving some sips of ORS on the way. So, if the two signs are present, severe dehydration. Then, if following to this, out of these four, restless child, severe dehydration, child was lethargic. Where in the other part, if the child is restless, irritable, eyes are sunken, drinks eagerly and thirsty, the skin pinch goes back very slowly. Slowly, not very slowly, slowly. It means some dehydration. Some dehydration, fluid plan B. In fluid plan B, give the child the oral dehydration solution, give zinc suspension, and after dehydration, we send home child with the mother and give ORS to give at home. At the same time, we advise the mother when to return immediately if any of the danger sign develop. Otherwise, you should come for the follow-up after 2 days. So students, look at the difference in the some dehydration and the severe dehydration. In the some dehydration, the child is irritable, wants to drink, eyes are sunken, skin pinch back goes slowly. While if the child has more full depletion, the child become lethargic. Now the child will not drink eagerly, at least will not be thirsty now. Will be dehydrated, just lying comatose like, and eyes will be sunken. And skin pinch goes back very slowly. So this is severe dehydration, while some dehydration we have seen. If mother complains ke bacche ko dast lage hue hain, bahut motion kar raha hai, but the child is not lethargic, not irritable, drinks normally, there is no sunken eyes, there is no skin pinch backs go slowly, it's just you release and it becomes normal. It means there is no dehydration and the child does not need any drug. In fact, what the child needs is a plan A. Plan A is for no dehydration, give fluid and food, treat and treat diarrhea at home. Means ask the mother to give him more fluid, give him more lassi, dahi, water, juices, soup, etc. She may give also ORS, start saying. But at the same time, if the mother says that child has loose motion and there is no dehydration, you ask mother to come after 2 days and tell her the danger signs. So now students, we have done with the dehydration. The only thing left is that if the child has blood in the stool, it means dysentery. For the dysentery, needs 3 days oral adequate antibiotic treatment for the Shigella. Give the zinc sulfate, zinc suspension for 10 days. Now the tablet is also available. And similarly, we will advise the mother to return immediately or the follow-up, or otherwise come to follow-up in 2 days. So for the diarrhea, very important, I briefly revise it. If a child comes with a diarrhea problem, like the mother says that the child is having loose stool, what we'll do? We will ask 2 questions only. What are those questions? How long the diarrhea is? Is there blood in the stool? अम्मा ये बताओ बच्चे को कितने दिन से मोशन हो रहे हैं, क्या मोशनों में, क्या दस्तों में खून तो नहीं आ रहा? These 2 questions you will ask. Then we look at the general condition of the child. Is the child lethargic, unconscious, or restless, or irritable? And number 2, we'll look for the sunken eyes. Number 3, we'll offer the child the fluid. There is a possibility child may not able to drink, or drinking poorly, or child may be drinking eagerly or thirsty. Number 4 is we will pinch the skin of the abdomen and see how the skin pinch back goes. On the basis of assessment, on the basis of these signs, we classify the child as either, if a child comes with a diarrhea, there will be 3 possibilities. First possibility, no dehydration, no such sign we have seen. Other possibility is some dehydration, and third is the severe dehydration. For the no dehydration, plan A, home treatment with the fluid and the diet. Plan B for the some dehydration, and plan C for the severe dehydration. This is very important. Student from it learn all these signs and things. So we have come now with the 3 things. Number 1, if a child comes with to child under 2 months to 5 years of age, we'll look for the general danger sign. They will ask, क्या बच्चे को खांसी है? We'll go to cough and assess accordingly. If the mother says नहीं जी खांसी नहीं है, then we will ask, और क्या है? बोले कि दस्त है, पतले पतले मोशन कर रहा है. We'll assess for the diarrhea. And if she says कि नहीं, इसको ना खांसी है ना कफ है, इसके कान में दर्द है. So we go to the ear problem. In the ear problem, we ask, is there severe ear pain? Is there ear discharge? If yes, how long? Just 2 questions. कान में क्या बहुत ज्यादा दर्द हो रहा है? क्या कान से कुछ निकल रहा है और कब से निकल रहा है? एंड वी विल जस्ट लुक 2 थिंग्स. लुक एट द पस ड्रेनिंग फ्रॉम द ईयर एंड फील फॉर द टेंडर स्वेलिंग बिहाइंड द ईयर. ओनली 2 क्वेश्चंस टू आस्क एंड 2 थिंग्स टू लुक फॉर. इज देयर सीवियर ईयर पेन? इज देयर ईयर डिस्चार्ज? इफ यस, हाउ लॉन्ग? एंड देन लुक एट द पस ड्रेनिंग फ्रॉम द ईयर और फील फॉर द टेंडर स्वेलिंग बिहाइंड द ईयर. एंड ऑन द बेसिस ऑफ दिस, let's go in bit detail of this in a minute, please. Severe ear pain and ear discharge. Inflammation of the middle ear cavity behind the eardrum leads to agonizing pain, severe pain. If the mother is not sure, ask if the child has been continuously irritable, crying and rubbing his ear. These are the signs and symptoms of severe ear pain. Then Fluids accumulates and causes pain through increase in the pressure in the medullary cavity. If we know that if we do not treat it adequately, then there will be the rupture of the tympanic membrane and the air discharge will be there. This is the consequences of the otitis media, and the ear pain is a symptom for that. And when the rupture of the eardrum occurs, the pus discharge from the ear. It's like this. Look at the pus draining from the ear. Eardrum has ruptured, and now the pus is coming out, drains into the ear canal, external, you can see now that. This is the pus coming from the ear, pus drainage from the ear. If tender swelling behind the ear, you look, if the child comes to you with an ear problem, you will ask how long the, if there is severe pain, how long the pain is there, and how, is there any ear discharge? You will look for the air discharge, and second thing we look is a tender swelling behind the ear, that is the an indication of the mastoiditis. Bilateral, bacterial deep infection of the mastoid cells behind the ear, it's a serious condition, it requires urgent referral because it may lead to meningitis in the brain axis. So, on the basis of our assessment, we classify the child with the ear problem into four categories. Number one category is the child has tender swelling behind the ear. Yes, okay, we missed this slide, sorry. And then we have missed, but we have not concentrated on the picture of this. This is very important. This is the area where the swelling, look at this picture. This is the area where the behind the ear where there may be swelling. If the swelling is in this area, it means there is a chances of mastoiditis. The mastoiditis is a serious condition because if we do not treat adequately, it may lead to the meningitis and the brain abscess. So on the basis of this assessment, we classify the child with the ear problem into number one, mastoiditis, tender swelling behind the ear. We give first dose of an appropriate antibiotic, treat the child to prevent low blood sugar level, give first dose of paracetamol for the fever pain, and refer child to the hospital. If you're sitting in the civil hospital, it does not mean you refer, it means you treat the child in the hospital with the injectable drugs. Second condition is that if the pus is seen draining from the ear and the discharge is reported less than 14 days, or there is severe pain, either one, if the severe ear pain is there or the pus is coming from the ear, we label it as the acute ear infection. And for the acute ear infection, what we do, we give an appropriate oral antibiotic for 5 days, give paracetamol for fever. We dry the ear by wicking, do not put any ear drops. Dry the ear by wicking by making a cotton or some tissue paper, but do not use the Q-tips or the sticks. Advise mother when to return immediately, danger signs, and otherwise come for follow-up in 5 days. The third thing is that if there is ear discharge, but this ear discharge is for more than 14 days, we label it as chronic ear infection. For the chronic infection, we dry the ear by wicking. If the pus is seen, we give paracetamol. We can give antibiotic, topical antibiotic drops, usually quinoline ear drops, give paracetamol for fever or pain, and we refer the child for the ENT because this child needs further assessment. There is rupture of the ear tympanic membrane for a long time, whether it needs repair or whatever it is. So, and advice to come follow 5 days. Fourth quarter, it means that the child has no ear infection. And for this child, if there is any other problem present, give appropriate treatment. Or child is having some problems, some foreign bodies in their etc. will refer to ENT. So today, students, we have seen the outline of the IMNCIE, danger signs, cough, diarrhea, ear problem. In the next lecture, we'll cover the remaining part of this. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. We conclude the today's session now. Thank you, Anis. Anis, now you can close the meeting.